Welcome to the State Fair at Salem, Oregon. This is our historical display of China painting, which is commonly known today as porcelain art. The piece you're now looking at was painted around 1920. It is a factory piece, not signed. The pieces you're now looking at is the Picard. It also is not signed. Normally signed, but it isn't signed. This one, we don't know for sure where it comes from. It was painted around 1920. This little sugar bowl probably graced a very wealthy family at one time. If you notice the colors that are being chosen for Picard and the amount of gold, this is their trademark. This little piece, I wish I knew exactly where it came from, but it is so delicate. It's a lovely base. The pieces we're now looking at are pieces that were painted in Japan. They were painted in a factory, but unsigned. Most of the work that was painted in factories was unsigned. Picard was the only one that was signed. The boxes that you're now looking at were painting boxes that were made around 1920 for the China painters. And you can see arrays of books that are spread out on the shelf, and below is the original ceramic magazine, which was the magazine of the China painter. This case shows a display of pieces that were done in the more modern day. On the bottom shelf is Dresden. The upper shelves are more naturalistic painting. All of these were done by the same artist, Kathe Leigh. This one is a picture of a vase that was done. And the pieces below that are in the display case are the pieces submitted to the magazine for reproduction, and they were lithographs. Two little eggs, bisque, a bisque box, painted by Beverly Stowe of Washington. And as you can see, there's another little bowl here. You can barely see the design because it's on the inside of the bowl. This vase also has the painting on the inside of the vase. These two little eggs, painted with enamel. And then a vase that stands beside it was painted by Joanna Barker of Montana. Again, the lithographs show the pieces as they were when they were used to submit designs to the ceramic magazine and other magazine that they had available. I'm not sure that they had any other available, but at this time, the pieces that are there are showing you now what we are doing today, most of our work today. This is bisque boxes and vase, and a little picture in the background by Ruth Venable. Another box, we can see the design on the side but not on the top. This is the piece by Joanna Barker, a closer shot of this piece. Very beautiful. Mountain ash. This particular piece is a piece done by Lee Linus of Salem, Oregon. She was a long-standing teacher and artist here. The flyer here is for OPAR. It's the school that teaches China painters once a year, and it has been going on for about 14 years. It'll be 15 years this year. This particular flyer shows all of the artists that are intending to teach in the school this year. It also has information about the school. More pictures of vases that have been done recently. This is one piece that is going to be submitted to the school by Kathe Leigh. It's a vase with an eagle motif. Kathe Leigh is getting ready to do her demonstration. The demonstrations this year were sponsored by the Willamette Valley Porcelain Artists of Salem. There were at least six artists there during the Friday and Saturday segments of the fair. Now we're ready to paint. And as you can see, we're holding about a 10-inch plate there. You can't see anything on it yet because that's the way the plate looks when you first get it. It doesn't have anything on it at all. We have to put the design on with our brushes and paints. And you notice too that the brushes that we have laid out before the painter is going to be a variety of sizes and shapes for different causes. The brush used there is the scroller brush. It's a number 8 scroller. It's being loaded with red paint, in this case yellow red, and I am sketching the shapes of some flowers. This would be geraniums eventually. There's a leaf being sketched on first fire. You sketch on the leaves and the flowers, no background. The next brush we're going to be handling is a ferrule brush that's 3/4 inch. It's made with natural bristles, in this case, squirrel hair, sometimes called a sable brush. It's worked first in the medium. The medium is a mixture of oils that we work into our brush, and then we pick up the color. In this place, it's yellow-red, and we're getting a full load of color onto the brush, and you can see the red on the brush because it has a full load of color. Then we're going to brush that in to the ovicular shape with smooth, flat, even strokes. Reloading the brush so that we can fill the next oval that has been drawn in. And put a little bit on that small shape off to the left. Next, we're going to take a piece of silk and wrap it over the index finger. And we're going to tap out the light area on this flower, the geranium, to indicate the area of light that's going to be traveling through that particular flower. Make it larger than life on the first fire because you need to have more light than you're going to need all through the painting. You can always narrow it down on other fires, but on the first fire, you will make your light area larger than you need it to be. Then recarve the outside edges to make it look a little more interesting so that it's not quite so rounded. This flower in the front, in the foreground, is going to be the main flower, and it's going to be facing toward us more. So we are going to need to make that one a little lighter on the top, reshaping it. This is the process known as feeling the flower. You're just going to tap some light area. It's a cluster flower, so it takes quite a bit of work to put this all together. But at this point, what you're doing is just softening the area and adding the light next. We're going to be using the wipeout tool to carve some interesting shapes underneath the flower. At the base of each flower is a section called the umbrella stem. It's the only flower like this, and each stem has a flower on the end of it. The other cluster flowers are not quite so. They occasionally have only four petals in their flowers, and they're smaller, and they might have a network that holds all the stems up to the flowers. But this particular flower doesn't. It has one stem for each flower bloom. The wipeout tool has to be cleaned off often to remove the excess amount of paint that it collects when it does the work. Now we're reshaping the flower a little, creating that light area. There we go. Right now we're using the wipeout tool to redefine the shape of the flower, going around some of the outside edges so that we can create a sharper edge, clean it up so that it's not quite so fuzzy, it hasn't been so disturbed by the use of the brush. Carving into the edge brings the light sharper into the flower. And here we've made a small stem that goes to one of the flowers. This is a process that will be enlarged upon on second fire. It's a process called carving. We are sharpening up the edges. We're adding openings, interesting openings, and reshaping the flower shapes or the flower petals so that they stand out against the background. This one, we need to make it stand out a little bit more against the background because it is our main subject matter. Each wipe with the wipeout tool, each stroke of the wipeout tool, sharpens that all the way down to the china so that the white shows through. Thank you. these cluster flowers have larger flowers within the cluster than the average of the others, I should say. All the others have smaller flowers. It's more tedious work. And the work that we do with the geranium is the first of the cluster flowers that you should learn because it's simpler. It's recognizable because it has 5 petals. It's larger, so it's easier to work with. We don't have to do quite as many in a cluster. And now the stem comes into play. I'm going to enlarge on that stem a little bit. The green is now applied in the same way that we applied the red. Now you can see the shape of the leaf a lot better. This is our main leaf. Notice the heart shape to the leaf. It really doesn't have a point at the bottom. Unless you are making a turn back, and then it will form a point at the bottom from the turn back. We just made the spokes in the leaf with a wipeout tool. The shape of the leaf is such that each individual vein line forms a spoke like a wheel going around in a circle. And they all connect up to the main vein line in the center. Synthetic brush is used to come back and take some of the color out. And then we leave a little bit of the color behind. By wiping away from that color line, knowing that we're going to leave that little bit of color, and then laying that brush on the top area above that color, and leaving more color so that we have more vein lines inside the leaf. That we soften the color away a little bit with the synthetic brush so that you will continue to get this nice soft color or this soft light in your leaf. Then you use your wipeout tool to come back into this leaf and sharpen the vein lines and leave just a little bit of really sharp light. And once that sharp light has been put in, and turnbacks are made, then we can take the synthetic brush again and work with this to soften those lines so that they're not so harsh and bring a softness to the light that is coming onto the leaf. Notice we're turning that plate because we have to work in it in a way where we're constantly pulling the brush toward ourselves. We're working that turn back with that brush, that synthetic brush, by pulling it, the brush back around the leaf in a direction of the turn back, the way that it has turned over. There's your leaf so far. There's a small turn back on this opposite side where it kind of curls over. And we're taking the wipeout tool now and we're giving it a little bit of a jagged edge because it is kind of ruffled at the bottom. It's kind of irregular. So you just push with that wipeout tool to cause that irregular edge, and then soften it a little bit on the outside edge of the turnbacks and things. There we go. Since the wipeout tool is being used again to sharpen the highlight, bring the greatest amount of light into that leaf that we can. You can't get the light back if you diminish it too quickly. So on the first fire, you make sure that you save lots of light, more light than you need, so that you can always come back and narrow that light down just a little bit. Switching back and forth with the synthetic brush and the wipeout tool. Synthetic brush comes after you use the wipeout tool so that you can soften that light area. Now we have one leaf and two flowers. Secondary leaf is put in. So that it doesn't look straight on like the original leaf did, the first leaf. The first leaf is your main leaf, so you want to draw lots of attention to it, and you're going to diminish the size of this leaf and turn it away from you, or away from the viewer, I should say, so that it's a much more interesting shape. It's facing away from the viewer. Lots of things can be done with that leaf to make it even more interesting. On the original plastic that we did the demonstration on, it shows some different things that were done earlier on to explain to someone how we get the effects that we do. Notice the leaf at the bottom and the main subject flower, the main leaf as well. The main leaf has a pattern on it, but on this fire, the pattern is left off. Because if you put it on this fire, you risk getting into the wet paint with your paint and disturbing everything that you have already done and cause a problem that you may have to try to correct, and that may not be such an easy chore. So you leave that for another fire. The stems are in pink in this fire as well, as you notice. We don't bother to put any green over the pink because we can fire that, and then the red will be fired and you could use it as a highlight on another fire. This piece has been fired already, and it has been done in pink. It does show another option, but it is kind of pale at this point, so it's a little difficult to deal with. But, you know, it is at the stage where you will be able to add some colors to it. It has already been fired a couple of times. And you can see that the patterns are already on some of the leaves and so forth, but the patterns are faint. They're not as strong as they will be at a later time. You notice that the stems are already painted in green, and all the leaves at the top and so forth have been put in. Because this particular piece is a little larger, and you can see that the stem line is a little long and rangy, so we have put a couple of small leaves across that stem line to make it not look quite as long, to break the length of the stem so that it doesn't become disturbing to the viewer. Also, you'll notice that the background with these flowers, when you get to a certain stage, this is the finished one, but when you look at the background, you can see that there is background in the background already. You know, there's some subject matter in the background. That subject matter is what we call carving. It's subjects of the same nature, in other words, they're the same as the foreground, that are not necessarily cast against a wall or anything, but they are shadowy shapes that have been in close proximity to the main subject matter. And the leaf forms and so forth have been much greener because we put another color of green on top. This is a three fire, at least three fires, possibly four, in order to get some of the depth that we need in some of the flowers. The green stems are important because they become the line of design that travels through the piece and exits at the bottom so that the eye travels through the painting. This would be something similar to a watercolor, in that we put a base color of yellow on and then use the red in the background to blush in or fade in across the yellow, which gives it a watercolor look. Now here's our piece where we are working on it. We still are at first fire on this particular piece. But the explanation is to show the viewers that it doesn't stop there. That's only the beginning. This is our base. Now we have something completely different. We're going to paint the background around these little subjects. Fact is that the subject matter doesn't show up very good until we put the background on. We're going to put this greenish color on the background around the subject matter, which happens to be two little birds in a nest. In this way, we frame up the subject matter. The birds have already been painted once, so they're on the piece, but the background needs to go around these little birds so that we can show where the little downy feathers come into the background. We're using a 3/4 inch brush again, smoothly shaping the two little birds sitting there in a nest. We're going to use a soft sponge. It's kind of like a packing sponge, or you can use cosmetic sponge, and you can pounce the color softly but firmly so that you can get this worked across the piece and kind of soften the edges around it so that you can come back to it on a later fire and do more work. It'll blend right in. Now we're going to use our silk to kind of clean this up a little bit, add a little more space if it looks like it needs it, reshape what we have possibly pushed aside a little bit, you know, like maybe we've kind of lost sight of our shape a little bit, so we're going to reclaim that shape and leave enough light around the subject matter. Again, if you obliterate the light, you're going to lose it forever and you won't have a chance to do anything with it. You can always bring it down on another fire if you wish. Bring it in a little bit, you know, so that it becomes narrower or smaller. Next, we're going to use a scroller brush to come back into the little face of the bird. One of the birds is awake, the other one is kind of sleeping. We'll take some color and paint it in to his little eye. It's imperative that we get the eye correct. We need to work with the eye before we do anything else to the little bird. This is true of all birds and animals and portraits. You always start with the eye first. But in this case, we did some of the work in the background to frame up the little bird. We had already done the eye beforehand. Everything has already been put on the piece. It has had one fire. And now we're going to sharpen up that eye so that it gets just the right amount of shape, just the right amount of depth. The eyes are extremely important. Mm-hmm. are happy with it, you can take your wipeout tool and come back around the eye a little bit to sharpen up the edges so that it's nice and clear and crisp. Then we'll take a rubber pick, come back into the eye and give it a little highlight. Now working with a small square shader, this is probably another number 4, we're going to come around the eye and shape the little beak. Use fluffing strokes. That means that you're going to lay the brush on and just fluff the color around the eye and up next to the beak. Now we're using the scroller. Very carefully. We're painting the opening. There he is, looking happier all the time. His little face is beginning to form. Now we need to put some shadow between the two birds. We will add a little bit of dark green to our brown, so that we create kind of a grayish color. are. Looking now at the second bird. We have to turn the plate sometimes to get a better angle. Always working around the shape of the head. It's not a flat surface, it needs to be rounded. We need to give it volume. Now we're using our scroller brush to lay in a little color on the eye line to define the eye. And to define the beak. Of the second bird. The wipeout tool can help to make it sharper by pushing the paint. Setting up the head. To give it more roundness. Thank you. Now we're working the lower feathers on the wing of the bird that is next to the the other bird. It has a little wing that comes out over the top of the other bird. So we're adding some darker feathers in there, because some of the feathers down at the bottom are the feathers, the new feathers. It's under the down. Bring the feathers over the top of the nest edge. Adding a little bit of dark over the top of the wing feathers, and now we're bringing a little bit of the dark area over the back of the bird so that we can give it a more rounded look and place it inside the nest. They're beginning to come to life, aren't they? Look how soft and sweet they are. Painting portraits is especially wonderful on china. The translucency of the plates and the tiles is so wonderful for portraits. It gives them a special glow. This portrait has been already traced on so that we can speed it up a little bit. You can barely see the lines and so forth that I'm going to be working with, but it does have enough line work that we can start to work with it. And of course, the main thing that we need to remember is this is a portrait. It means eyes first. We'll use a scroller. To put some blue paint. This is the choice of color that we've decided on for the eyes. Put the color in the eyeball and shape it very carefully, using the tip end of the number one or aught scroller. This portrait even though it's fairly large. The eyes are rather small. It's rather tedious work because you have to look very carefully at the eyes and make sure that you get the eyes right on center. They have to be looking correctly, or tracking, in other words. This is what we call it, is tracking, to make sure that the eyes are looking in the distance at the right place, or looking at something at the right place. This portrait is a three-quarter view, which is a little more difficult. You see how the eyes have been put in. Next, we go down to the mouth, and we're going to very carefully paint in the mouth and reshape it until we get the shape that we want. These are the most important features of the face, the eyes and the mouth. Portraits take a great deal of looking. If you put your makeup on in the morning, you get a chance to see your face on a constant basis and work with the features of the face a great deal. If you never put makeup on, it may make it a little bit more difficult. But you can always look at your face and examine all the features of your face, and it will help you to paint your portraits. Reshaping the face or the mouth with the wipeout tool. Moving the paint around until it is in the position that you want it to be. Using that brush on the corners to push that color into the corners of the mouth. We're using a synthetic brush to take the corner and lift off a little bit of paint in the center of the mouth to get the highlight. keep turning the plate so that you continually pull the brush toward you. We are now taking a little brown and making the shadows in the corners of the eye and up under the eyebrow. We're using a brush that is about a number 4 square shader with sable hairs to give it a nice soft look. We're going to bring that color down underneath the eye to form the eye sockets, and then brush it softly away from the nose toward the cheek area. From time to time, we have to stop to talk to onlookers.